Hi, this video is on some more arguments for the existence of God, the ontological, the moral argument, and the argument from the existence of evil. These are the three arguments I want to talk about in this video. I've done two other videos on arguments for the existence of God. The first one on the cosmological argument, which is the argument from cause. We might call it the sound of music argument. Nothing comes from nothing. Nothing ever could. And therefore, there must be a God. And so the idea that there's some sort of creator or that there's some kind of a first cause makes sense because we're used to effects having causes in the universe. Second video was on the argument from design or the so-called teleological argument. This is the idea that the universe displays a certain order, the fine-tuning argument for the existence of God. There's a fine-tuning to the universe that if the laws of nature weren't on a razor's edge, you know, then we wouldn't be here. And so the idea that there must be surely an intelligent designer behind this whole thing. So those two arguments we've already presented. This video is more about the ontological argument and the moral arguments and the argument for the existence of evil. I don't find these arguments quite as convincing, although maybe that's because I don't fully grasp the profundity of the ontological argument. Some have considered the ontological argument to be the most profound argument for the existence of God. I haven't seen it. When philosophers come up with stuff and your response is, huh? You know, there's two possibilities at least. One is, wow, I'm not smart enough to understand this, or I just haven't gotten this yet. The other one is, they're just crazy. And there's a lot of crazy philosophy throughout the centuries. But anyway, let's go ahead and dig in. Let me reiterate what I've said before. I don't think that our human mind can prove the existence of God. I'm sure God can prove his own existence. That if God were to lecture us on his existence, oh, wow. And if he gave us a little extra brain space, you know, we'd be able to see it. However, I don't think that belief in God, faith in God, is a matter of proof necessarily. There are some who come to Christ that way. I think that arguments for the existence of God tend to bolster the faith we already have rather than lead people to faith. Usually apologetics is more confirming to those who already have faith than convincing to those who don't. There are exceptions, C.S. Lewis, Joshua Dow, and so forth. Let's dig into these final arguments for the existence of God that we're presenting. There are lots of them. There's a book coming out this summer, something like 20 some arguments for the existence of God from a lecture that Plantinga gave once on the fly. Maybe it wasn't on the fly. Okay, the ontological argument. So the ontological argument most famously is traced back to Anselm in the 1100s in his Proslogion, in which he made an argument something like this. Now, I've simplified it to make it clearer, or I think more clearer. For a long, long time, I felt like, I just don't understand this. I'm not smart enough to understand this argument. And then I concluded, the reason I don't understand it is because it doesn't make sense. Now, you may have a different reaction to it, but let me go ahead and present the argument as I understand it. So Anselm basically said, first of all, that I can conceive of the greatest possible being. I can conceive of a being a greater than which there is not. I can conceive of that, Anselm suggested. And I can conceive of I can conceive a little bit. I'm not sure I can conceive totally what God would be like or what God is like. I think I can conceive some of that. Basically, take every category and maximize it, and that's the greatest possible being. So I think I can conceive a little bit of what God is like, or if you don't believe in God, of what God would be like. I can conceive of the greatest possible being. Now, watch this. Now, the greatest possible being would not be the greatest possible being if the greatest possible being didn't actually exist. See what he's saying here? For God to be the greatest possible being, he wouldn't just be in my head. He'd be in the real world. So I can conceive of the greatest possible being, but that greatest possible being wouldn't be the greatest possible being if it only existed in my mind, and therefore the greatest possible being must exist outside my mind as well. Isn't that clever? if your reaction is, what? I think you're probably having the right reaction. Sometimes philosophers put these syllogisms together and it twists your brain into a pretzel and you think, oh, wow. But I think this doesn't work. Now, I could be wrong. I may be completely wrong. It's possible that I just haven't fully grasped this argument. I've tried over the years, and I think I grasp it, and I don't think it works. However, it may just be that I'm not smart enough. Let's go ahead and talk about some of the objections to this that have been made. One of the probably the first major objection to this argument was made by Immanuel Kant, who believed in God. Again, it's important to realize that just because an argument for the existence of God doesn't work doesn't mean that God has to pack up and go home. You know what I mean? God exists, you know, regardless of whether our arguments for him all work or not. So again, I believe in God, Kant believed in God. And so just because the ontological argument might not work doesn't mean that God doesn't exist. That would be a faulty conclusion as well. But anyway, what Immanuel Kant basically said, that this argument mixes logical apples and oranges. So it mixes what we might call a synthetic proposition with what we might call an analytical proposition. An analytical proposition is a proposition that is true by definition. And so the statement that God would not be the greatest possible being if God only existed in my mind is a analytical, or is it actually a synthetic proposition because it has to do with the real world, whereas conceiving of something is an analytical proposition. So what Kant would say is this is a conceptual proposition, and this is a real world proposition, and you can't mix those two together. Or what we might say from logical, remember the logical fallacies video, I would say that the word, in my version of the argument here, the word greatest is being used in two different ways. Greatest here means greatest possible. Greatest here means, wouldn't that be great? Anyway, just to be kind of approximate there. And so I do think that Kant probably is right, that this argument is mixing logical apples and oranges. Premise one and premise two don't really connect to each other in the way you might think at first. Can I provide a rebuttal? I provided a rebuttal to objections to these arguments before. Is there any way that we can get this ontological argument to work? This is a very empirical kind of thing to say. Does everything I conceive have some basis in reality? Not everybody has believed that. Kant certainly didn't believe that. Kant believed that I come with certain mind software that's preloaded onto my brain. Not many philosophers have not believed that everything in my head has a basis in reality. But we Americans, if you're American, tend to be very empiricist. You know, there's nothing in my head that wasn't first in my senses, as John Locke would say in the 1700s. So if everything that's in my head has some basis in reality, and again, that's not at all a foregone conclusion, then what is the basis in reality for my belief in God? Do people, and belief in God is a prevalent, is a near universal dimension to human culture. Humans have always, in terms of our historical memory, humans have always believed in the gods. And so where does that belief come from? Now, of course, there are atheists out there, of course, but they are historically deviant. I'm not saying you're a deviant in terms of your, I'm just saying that clearly atheism is the exception throughout history rather than the rule. So why is it that so many, the default human understanding is a belief in God? Is there something about the universe and about reality in which that basis, that belief comes from? Now Aquinas, I'm not sure that this works, but I like it. Aquinas had an argument from necessity. One of his five ways, you know, one of his five arguments for the existence of God was an argument from necessity. And the idea that is that a distinction between possible beings and necessary beings. So there are many things that are possible. So it's possible that this cell phone would exist. It's possible that I would exist. But I don't have to exist. My cell phone doesn't have to exist. The earth doesn't have to exist. The sun doesn't have to exist. In fact, when I look at the observable universe, it's not clear that anything has to exist. And so Aquinas basically argues that if every being is merely a possible being and not a necessary being, then it would be possible that nothing would exist. But if nothing were to exist, then there could never be something. And so there must be at least one necessary being. There must be at least one being or entity that exists of necessity. And this, Aquinas would say, we call God. That strikes me as a kind of ontological argument. The idea that there must be some ground of being. There must be some necessary being. Of course, what that necessary being is another question. Well, let me end my talk on the ontological argument by presenting Alvin Plantinga. Alvin Plantinga is, I believe he's still alive in 2018. He's a hero, a father of modern apologetics, very intelligent fellow. Was at Notre Dame, I think, at the end of his career, if I remember correctly. Alvin Plantinga, first of all, Alvin Plantinga believes that belief in God is properly basic. And what I mean by that is that he doesn't think that we actually need to argue for the existence of God because humanity believes in the existence of God. He believes that belief in God is intrinsic to human belief systems in the same way that you don't have to prove that 1 + 1 = 2. I guess you could prove that 1 + 1 = 2, but he believes that belief in God is properly basic and therefore is something that is so core to human belief that we don't even need to argue for it. However, he did provide an argument for it, his modal ontological argument. And let me go ahead and present it briefly. The argument basically goes like this. There is a, and again, I'm probably simplifying, I am simplifying highly complex arguments that these people have made. So first of all, there is a possible world in which God exists. This is the first premise of his argument. So a possible world is a world that could have been. So there's a possible world in which I don't exist. There's a possible world in which I have an identical twin, and so forth and so on. There's a possible world in which Starbucks sells peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. So his first point is there is a possible world in which God exists. Now, can we debate that? Yes, we can. We can debate whether or not that is an obvious premise. So here's a second point. If God exists in one possible world, God exists in all possible worlds. Now, this premise, I think, is true. This premise is true because by definition, if God exists, then God exists in every universe because God is the ground of all existence. So the debate point is this first one. Is there a possible world in which God exists? I agree with Plantinga. If there is a possible world in which God exists, then God must exist in all possible worlds, and therefore God must exist. But it's a circular argument. It assumes its conclusion in its premise. So there is a possible world in which God exists. That's what we're arguing. That's what we're debating. We're debating whether there is a possible world in which God exists. But I agree with Plantinga. If there is a possible world in which God exists, then God must exist in all possible worlds, and God must therefore exist. So a little bit on the ontological argument. Again, I don't want to say the ontological argument is wrong because it may be very true. In fact, by faith, I believe God is the ground of all being and that God must exist. I mean, so by faith, I believe these things. I'm just not sure that any of these arguments prove that God must exist from a standpoint of existence. Could be wrong. Okay, the moral argument from the existence of God. And again, I'm giving you my simplified versions of these things. So the moral argument for the existence of God, as I understand, goes a little like this. If God did not exist, there would be no basis for right and wrong. But right and wrong exists, therefore God exists. Now, I could see a skeptic questioning both of the premises, one and two. And so again, I think there's a little bit of circularity in this argument. Premise number two, that right and wrong exists, sure seems like it's the case. So it sure seems like it would be wrong for someone to take, just to go and shoot a complete innocent bystander on a sidewalk, or a child walking down the sidewalk for no reason. That's just, to run somebody over with your car for no reason. It seems like right and wrong exists, but that's a subjective claim, isn't it? There have been philosophers like Nietzsche who wrote Beyond Good and Evil. There have been philosophers who've argued that right and wrong doesn't exist, and so there is a certain circularity. I think this argument gives a motivation to want to believe that God exists, because we want there to be right and wrong. But I'm not sure that it actually proves, in the sense that we would have to demonstrate that there is a right and a wrong. Now, I believe there's a right and wrong, but you understand what I'm saying. There's a circularity, I think, to the use of this argument. Of course, there have been many philosophers who have disagreed with premise number one, that if God did not exist, there would be no basis for right and wrong. Although a lot of philosophers have basically located ethics in subjectivity. David Hume, we've mentioned, is a gentleman skeptic of the 1700s. And David Hume, basically considered moral arguments to be a matter of subjectivity, of wish, of desire, rather than of fact. David Hume talked about what he called the fact-value problem, that there is a gap between a fact like "it really hurts when you punch me," and the value "you shouldn't punch me." There's a valley between those two, and Hume called that the fact-value problem. Of course, in the modern age, there have been those who've argued that right and wrong is a matter of invention. Trying to remember, Lewis Poyman wrote a book. His ethics textbook was, I think, something like Discovering Right and Wrong. But he was riffing off of somebody who said something like inventing right and wrong. I should have looked that up, but it just occurred to me. But so there have certainly been 20th century philosophers who've argued that right and wrong is purely a matter of wish or of desire rather than of objective fact. And so this argument, I think, might be compelling if you want to believe in right and wrong, but I'm not sure that it actually is a strong logical argument. Again, I believe in right and wrong, don't get me wrong. C.S. Lewis in Mere Christianity argued that the existence that people believe in right and wrong in and of itself is a kind of argument for the existence of God. Again, I've never found that a really strong argument, but there are many that do. So I'll leave it at that. Very similar is the argument from evil. It takes a very similar form. If God did not exist as the definer of good, we would not be able to say that evil existed. Evil exists, therefore God exists. And I do think that this is a wake-up call for those who don't believe in God. So the Holocaust, if there is no God, I mean, I do find this argument forceful emotionally. Again, the question is, does evil exist? There are those who would, Machiavelli, might makes right and so forth. So there are those who believe that evil doesn't exist. But Dostoevsky wrote, if there is no God, then everything is permissible. And I do find that probably to be the case. That is to say that I'm not sure what the basis is for saying that the Holocaust was evil if there is no God, other than that from a human perspective, it is of course abhorrent. But that's a subjective kind of statement from within humanity, in the same way that a seal that's eaten by a you know, some predator, you know, might say, as a seal, it's evil for me to be eaten. But that doesn't mean it really is evil for the seal to be eaten. And so I do think that it's true that if there is no God to define what good and evil is, then a lot of the things that we say are evil have no basis for being said to be evil. There is a lot of moral indignation by people who don't believe in God. There are a lot of people in our culture today who strongly believe that certain things are evil, and yet they don't believe in God. I do believe that they probably don't have a leg to stand on with regard to the fervor and intensity with which they think those things are evil. And that's basically what this argument is saying. This argument is saying is that, in my opinion, the truth of this saying is that we really can't speak of evil if there is not some kind of a definition of good that is defined in a way, something like the existence of God. And so I do feel the force of this emotionally, because it seems like evil exists. And in order for it to truly be evil, there has to be some standard against which it is judged, and that standard is most logically God. However, this doesn't prove it, in my opinion. It motivates me to believe in God, but it doesn't necessarily rationally prove the existence of God. Well, these have been my analyses of three further arguments for the existence of God: the ontological argument, the argument, the moral argument, and the argument from the existence of evil. You will have to wrestle with them, and perhaps you are smarter than I am and will see some error in my analysis of them. But remember, a belief in God is ultimately a matter of faith rather than proof, in my understanding. Thank you very much.